from the high desert of Southern California and on the web at praiseyahuwah.com, announcing the kingdom of Yahuwah. And now it's time for truth with your servant host, Denya Cajaliero.
Barukiyah, shaloma, shaloma, shaloma. Blessings to you, and thank you for being here this morning with Dia and I, Denia, and we're here to praise Yahuwah on It's Time for Truth, our podcast. Thank you, Father Yahuwah, for this day, and we do pray every day, but and all day, but especially on the mornings of the broadcast, we ask Yahuwah to send us his helper so that we are saying and doing the correct things in the best way. We're not perfect, but we try to do the best job that we can, right, for Yahuwah. And so we love him, and it's with hearts that have a heart for Yahuwah in a pleasing nature, in a serving nature, and a humble nature that we're all working on. We live in a very prideful age. The scriptures have talked about the pride of the latter days and the pride of the people, and how that pride would actually be the thing that would cause the world, most of the world, I was reading last night, most of the world, which could be compared to a giant wave of water, would be destroyed, would not make it. And it would be as though a drop was simply the first fruits of his people and those who would be able to overcome. And we're working on that desperately, are we not? Because after all, what makes you different than the world? When you look at, you watch a lot of videos, I'm sure, like Dee and I do. We watch the YouTube videos. So we don't really watch movies or sitcoms or anything like that anymore. So we tend to focus more on learning and seeking in the Word. And so as we watch different people talk about their understanding of Scripture, you'll notice that you'll see a lot of, especially if you type in rapture, you type that in, you'll notice there's a lot of preachers and teachers in most of Christianity that are out there telling folks about a rapture that's coming. And most people believe that the rapture is just going to be this big event that the whole world is going to take notice of and see millions of people possibly just vanish, and they're, and all that's left is a pile of their clothes, right? And, you know, beyond that, they say you really don't have to do anything except come to church. And the important thing is to donate. Always that, right? There's always asking. If you notice every webpage you go to, and every video that you see, there's some sort of monetization. There's some sort of financial something financially part of that. And we don't want to be part of that. We don't want to be part of these groups that everything is all about earning money. And it's darn near like watching PBS. For those of you in other countries that may not have PBS, PBS is like this free television, but it's not really free because they have advertisers on it, right? So there's income coming in from people that donate, foundations that donate, and corporations that donate, advertisers that donate. But on top of that, there's this constant theme to the viewer, that the viewers like you, you know, need to donate. I feel the same way when I go, when I watch most of these videos and I go to most of these web pages that claim to praise Yahuwah. There's always the donate to me, give me, provide for me, do this for me. But we know that our focus is to be upon Yahuwah as our provider. He brings us the hidden manna. He brings us the birds of the sky for us to partake in, so to speak, which is really the great bird in Scripture would be known as really the Ruach, Yahuwah Ruach. and he is there for us. And he, through his various ways, does work things out on our behalf, the people that serve Yahuwah. He knows what you need and when you need it. Yahuwah numbers even the sparrows, and he knows what each one of them need and what they require. And so how much more you, his beloved, his first fruits, his family, to the greatest extent, he knows what you need. He knows what we don't need also, right? What we think we need, he knows we don't need. And he says, no, that's not going to be good for you. And I know what you can handle and what you can't handle. And so Yahuwah's people always are taken care of. They don't starve, and they don't not have a roof over their head. And we pray for him to give us that daily bread of knowledge, but also the daily bread of support. And he does that, and he makes ways for us to be able to do that. And the world turns religion into this financial thing. The Joel Osteens of the world, they would claim that you need to be focused on the fact that you will have plenty of financial aid, material things, comfortable, extremely comfortable life. He wants you to succeed. Well, so what does that mean for those who are on the lower end of the financial bracket? Does that mean for those set apart ones that he doesn't want you to succeed? No, you see, that's all cow dung, okay, that's being foisted upon you. And it's very satanic, extremely satanic. It's very hurtful, extremely hurtful. And it's the complete wrong focus of the world. It should be a complete 180 from that. Money should be something that you have to have just enough of. And we trust in Yahuwah because he will always look out for our future. But it isn't something that we have to say, well, something's wrong if I'm not being blessed financially. I'm to be blessed financially. He is going to bless you. Some people may fortunately have this or that that happens because of his kanan upon you. It just happens to be right for you. And others may not. But that's not a focus. And certainly the whole eternity, the whole of eternity, is something that is not even going to be focused on how much money you make and what you have compared to what other people have. You know, today, even the poorest people live better than some of the kings of many centuries ago. You turn on the water, you have cold water. You turn on the hot water, you have instant hot water. Just that act alone provides you what would have taken a dozen people to create, especially nonstop, instantly, to have all the ins and outs of what water does. Not to mention electricity and all the conveniences of some of the most basic appliances. Maybe we don't have the fanciest appliances. Maybe you don't have all the name brand, stuff from the local electronics store. But you have a lower end blender, but can you imagine the amount of work that saves you just to have a blender? You can go into any, thrift store today and for less than $10, almost outfit your entire kitchen with albeit very used, appliances, small kitchen appliances, but you can get, three, four different appliances for $10 and that do things that, again, would have taken many people to do. And the amount of people that it would take, even for a person living in a one bedroom apartment with some of the basics, the amount of people would be dozens and dozens and dozens. Think about the act of even using the restroom and how you don't have to cart off your waste, right? You don't have to bury it. You don't have to clean and do all these different things. It's all everything. And so how much nicer we live today than we could have ever hoped to be able to live in all these many thousands of years. You want a hamburger and a fries and a Coke? It's simply driving a couple minutes around the corner. Instant beef, right? Instant food. Again, all of that preparation would have taken dozens and dozens and dozens of people, but you have it all. So we really have no right to look at other people and say, why don't I have it as well as they do? You have it well. Yahuwah takes care of you. And for us to be in our hearts, sort of lusting after our near one's house or other things that are of our near ones, the benefit of our near one, is a slap in the face of Yahuwah. So why do we talk about that and all this? Because the religions today who do not keep covenant, they tickle the ears of the people, the masses. They tell them that they're going to be saved, and they're not. But everything looks so well packaged. Everything looks so good that those millions of Christians out there believe that there is salvation coming for them because of exactly the pathway that that preacher leads these people and the masses down and through to believe that, so that they can go away after a Sunday church gathering or meeting or whatever it is. They can go away after they've given their tithe, and they can feel like, okay, I'm good for another week. I'm saved, and I don't have any worries. Because after all, there's enough stress in the world, right? The stress we don't need necessarily, at least according to the world, is to worry about your eternal salvation. But that's the stress that we do need in a positive way. That's the focus that we do need to have in a positive way. Why? Because it is your eternal salvation. It is. When the churches tell you that you don't need to do this or that, you're saved by grace, they're lying to you. They're lying to all the people you know. They're lying to everyone on TV when they broadcast their programs, and the tens of thousands, some of these churches, people show up. They're being lied to so they can go away at the end of the day and feel good that they're saved, when in fact, you and I are only being saved. Master died, but that was so that you could repent. Otherwise, there'd be no need for repentance. It would be so that you could repent and focus on one thing at a time, overcoming. The scriptures constantly talk about overcoming and refining and washing our robes and making them white, making them, that act of making something white when you're washing something that has been stained. It's a lot of work to scrub that. Not as much these days because of the conveniences, but those of you who have been around for maybe 50 to 70 years or more, you know what it used to be like back in those early days when your mom would be out there scrubbing and how long it would take to get stains out. It's a work, it's a progress, and if it wasn't important, why would you go through all that much work to do that? Especially the most secret sin is pride. You can have all these other things handled, but you have that one aspect of your life, which is pride, which is the most prevalent thing among people. They'll go to church and act humble, and they'll leave. They think they're saved forever, and they walk in a prideful way. After all, they're financially blessed. I'm chosen. The Almighty has blessed me. All these financial things that I have are evidence that I am especially one of His. They think that way because that's really what's being taught, like we just said. But that pride is deceptive. And the pride is something that causes you to falsely believe that you're walking clean. Remember that, and one of the things that Master spoke about with regards to the Pharisees was that they We're so prideful in every single way that they displayed their daily activity, not their inner heart, not the inner person, which he said was dirty, but the outer activities of the day. They did everything just so. And if they saw somebody that wasn't doing it exactly right, it was like a garment tear fest. Oh, you know, oh, how could you do that? And that the attitude was very prideful of all, and it was a very 1984 lifestyle in that everybody was watching everybody. Everybody was turning everybody in. Somebody would go to the high priest or to one of his assistants and whisper, you know, so-and-so is doing it this way, or they're not doing it that way, and it's just so very churchy too, isn't it? Kind of cultic. I love how some churches love to point fingers, and people like to point fingers at cults and say, well, cults are defined by this or cults are defined by that. All churches are cults because they're all so controlling. That's why we can't belong to a church. That's why we don't formulate or create a congregation, if you will. We are all part of Yahuwah's congregation. You are the temple. So at nighttime, when you go to bed and you're, if that's when you like to read the word like I do, when you do that, you are kahaling, if you will, at that moment. You don't forsake gathering together. That's why many of you are here today, because this is a gathering. You're not forsaking that gathering, or those of you listening on the recorded broadcast with everybody else. It's a gathering of minds. We're all sort of spiritually gathered. And so we're not alone, because we are one with Master. We are one with Father. We are one with the Ruach. And we end up having to have that completeness within us, that allows us to not have to desperately seek. I've seen some folks have sent me emails that, and I know why, but they'll send me an email, you know, do you know where I've moved into this new area. Do you know where there's a gathering of a kahal of, you know, a congregation, a church, you know, anything that's they almost like go through this withdrawal that they've got to be in some sort of organized, church. And I always say, you know, you're going to have a hard time finding anybody that believes the word and believes the truth in the way that you and I do. So it's going to be tough. And because they don't believe the way that you and I do, they're also going to condemn you, which is also why the scriptures say that really, if someone is like that, you're not going to want to necessarily break bread and be part of that group, because they're going to constantly work on you until you conform to their rules and their laws and that particular cult. And so we say, don't be part of it. Also, when we're preaching and teaching and people go, well, Yahuwah and the Ten Commandments, is that a cult? Nope, we don't have a cult. We don't have a church. We don't tell people that you must do this or you must do that. We simply read the scriptures and recommend that this is what the word says. And you have choices to make. And those choices are yours, and it's between you and Yahuwah. And there's a line between shunning and not necessarily wanting to become best friends with somebody who's going to be working on you constantly about how you should be doing it this way or that way. Well, you shouldn't, you know, do this or you shouldn't do that. You know, the typical thing. It's so prevalent. But the scriptures are very simple, like we spoke about last week. And that's why pride, I was reading in the book of Esdras, that pride is just one of these things that's going to destroy that whole wave of people, and that there would only be a drop that would be his. The scriptures say this over and over for a reason, brothers and sisters. Christians make up of a lot of people here in the United States. Maybe not in the whole world. We're certainly not as great as some religions, but it makes up a large percentage of the world. And if the scriptures say that entire wave is going to be lost, save just a few, you have to wonder then, why are these teachings, what are in these teachings that these people are learning that are causing them to lose their eternal salvation? It's very simple. In Matthew 19, our master said in if you turn to verse 16, and it's important to do this, brothers and sisters, because the covenant is something that we show Yahuwah that we care about, we love, and every day is to be a covenant day. So we do speak about covenant. People say, why do you always talk about covenant? Nobody really says that anymore, but you know, I've had that. Why do you always, every day, you know, it's covenant? That's because that's the main thing that we're, see, they don't understand that this is the main thing. All the prophets declared covenant, right? All the stories and scriptures were all about what happened to people if they didn't keep covenant. And even Master said, you must keep covenant. So church leader, pastor, minister, priest, elder, whoever you are, you're telling people that they don't have to keep the covenant, namely, especially Shabbat. But in all truth, there's a couple others that are inconvenient for you that you won't necessarily admit to. Though most are those that everybody knows they should follow. But when you tell your congregation you don't keep covenant, you're saved under grace, then you just slapped our master Yahuwah in the face, Matthew 19:16. And see, one came and said to him, great teacher, what shall I do to have everlasting life? And he said to him, why do you call me great? No one is great except one. Eloi-am. But if you wish to enter into life or have eternal salvation, everlasting life. Because remember, this young one said, what do I need to do to have that everlasting life? He says, if you wish to enter into everlasting life, guard the commandments. Keep the covenant. Keep the Ten Commandments. Keep to the way. And then, so that this wouldn't be mistranslated or misunderstood, what exactly our master was referring to. Was he referring to the commands of Moshe? No, he was talking about the covenant word that Yahuwah gave Moshe, the 10 covenant words. Because he went on to say that, because he said to him, which, in verse 18. And Yahuwah, he told him, he says, all the 10 commandments. Even though it only lists the second half of the covenant, it's by virtue of what is being stated, telling you keep all these 10 commandments. He's not telling you only keep half of them. I believe that the half was taken out. That was yet another change in scripture of evil. But that's a convenient way for the churches to be able to not keep the first half of the covenant. Because the first half isn't there in Matthew 18, and the very ending of the covenant isn't there in 18. Does that mean we don't have to keep any of those? No. He said, you know, don't murder, don't commit adultery, don't steal, blah, blah, blah. But because of the fact that you know that these covenant words guard the commands, he said. He didn't say guard just the second half. Guard the commands. Keep the commandments. Declare the commandments. So this young man, when he heard this, he was sad because he had many possessions, it said, right? And that is part of pride. If you are going to lose all your many possessions or give them away, then you're giving in to humility and you're shunning prideful materialism. And so Master knew this and he declared this pride of possessions that is exactly what is being taught. Pride of financial gain and pride of having things and pride of making money a focus is something that the world does. And we're not to do that. And pride is the thing that is going to cause most of the world to not make it into eternal salvation. Think of how big a camel is as a creature. Now think how small the eye of a needle is in relation to that camel. When Master said in 24 of chapter 19, again, I say to you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the reign of Eloi-am. That's that wave of people when only one drop's going to make it. So the young man, he had said in verse 20 that all of these covenant words I have watched over from my youth. What do I still lack? See, at least he was keeping the covenant words. But A, he wasn't doing them in the way of Yahuwah. B, he had this pride, this sin of pride. It isn't that you can't have financial things and make it into everlasting life. It's that having financial things and being greatly blessed causes you to have a pride that will keep you from being in eternal salvation. You and I, even some of the poorest people, have very many possessions, as we just got through speaking about. We have a lot, but we're not thankful or grateful for what we have. So we're always looking at other things and what other people have. And we've got to stop making life, the financial aspect of life, our focus. Many possessions. You notice it didn't say that he had lots of money, but that he had many possessions. We assume he had lots of money because of having many possessions. But see, you and I, we have lots of possessions. If you went through your home, you know, I've been an insurance, property and casualty, agent, in my life for a couple of decades now. And though I'm making working to make a career change in, catastrophic claims adjusting, I have learned so much in people's what they have in their homes, their property, their possessions. I've learned about, you know, what in certain areas, what people have financially and what other areas people don't. One of the things I notice that when people have claims, when they have insurance losses, or when they insure possessions, is that they have so much more than they even realize that they have. People don't realize how much they have until they actually document down everything that they have. And even people on the lower end of the financial spectrum have so much. Having many possessions can take our focus away from Yahuwah. And we are all guilty of this. So I always tell people, get rid of the stuff that you don't use on a daily basis. Having more clutter actually is bad for you. Look, get rid of things you don't need. Sell things you don't need. You could use those funds for money. You could use that fund for a solid investment for your future, right? They say, well, why would you invest in the future? Because we don't know the day and the hour. I came out of a cult called Jehovah's Witnesses that told everybody in 1975 that the world was ending. People maxed out their credit cards. They maxed out their mortgages. They quit their jobs. They bought things that they figured, well, it ain't going to matter anyway. I'm just going to go ahead and buy this and enjoy it right now because the end of the world's coming. And then, of course, subsequently in 1976, the Jehovah's Witnesses had more bankruptcies than probably any other religion because of what they did. So no, we prepare for the future, but we expect his kingdom to come any day. The good news demands that we do that, that we expect that. So Master told us exactly what would be one of the main issues, especially in the latter days. The book of Esdras also declared some very important things that we're going to learn about today. So if you have an Apocrypha, I would like you to turn, if you would, to the second book of Esdras. Now, we will reread the first and second book of Esdras down the road. It's just that important. The book of Esdras is one of the greatest books that I've ever read. It's one of those top prophetic books. If you like the book of Enoch, if you like Jeremiah, if you like Isaiah, Ezekiel, if you like these prophetic books that declare some amazing things, the book of Esdras is one of those. And One of the ways that you know the book of Esdras is blessed is because I always say this. If you read any of these books, whether they're in the Bible or not, you get a certain flavor for that writer that this is a prophetic book. You get a certain feeling about it that resonates with the Ruach. And you begin to read that and you will see consistently certain things. One of the things that you're going to see is that it will proclaim the importance of the great name. The other thing that it will declare is the way, the covenant way, the importance of keeping covenant, just like Master said. And then lastly, the third thing it will consistently do, and this is 99% of prophets, and if a prophet doesn't declare all three of these things, it's probably because the book is missing chapters at the end or something. But the last thing is it declares the good news, which is the coming kingdom and the coming ascension or taking or gathering or rapturing of Yahuwah's people before the garbage hits the oscillating fan, before that specific rapture is mentioned. And so Esdras, the second book of Esdras, let's turn there to chapter 1. Now, before we get started, the churches today teach saved by grace. So they're missing the key element of the eternal covenant, word of Yahuwah. And if they teach to keep the Ten Commandments, they might teach to keep the Shabbat and all these things, but then they fall down when it comes to treating the name. Importantly, they don't do it. They don't focus on it. And that's why the second thing is that great name. And all the ins and outs of the Ten Commandments are about love, loving Yahuwah and loving our neighbor. But if you're a prideful person, if you're the type of person that your belongings are so important to you, your business is so important to you, that you are so important as a person, your finances, you know, making more money, finding, you know, making that the focus of your day in and day out. If that is the way that you say, well, I have to do this. Well, you might think you have to do it. And certainly if you don't work, you don't eat. But we're not talking about working and eating. We're talking about your day in and day focus is constantly money, 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 money. How you're going to get it and how important you are because you have it. Churches are the same way. So why wouldn't the people be the same way? And so your focus is a prideful focus instead of it being a focus on loving Yahuwah, loving your neighbor. What does it say in scripture that when these people had funds, but they had come to Master, or they had gathered themselves together as brothers and family, different than a church, but now as really family. What does family do? Family helps one another, right? Family, if you have excess and you have a family member that doesn't, and that family member comes to you and says, you know, I need an operation or I'm not going to eat today. Really, that's, you know, and you know that family member is a hardworking person. It's a good person. They're serving Yahuwah. They're doing everything that they could do, but maybe they gave away something to somebody else and now they don't have, perhaps. You help that person. You look out for that person. You ask that person, how are you doing financially? You know that you have a lot of excess and they don't. How are you doing financially? Well, I'm fine. I'm okay. Well, you say you're okay, but do you have a coat for this winter? No, not yet. You know what? I'm going to get you a coat for this winter. That's concern. It isn't just giving money away. Because that's really not what it's all about. It's making sure that people have the basics of things. We're blessed because we have the basics of things in this world. Even the poorest people have the basics. So our focus needs to be on Yahuwah. Loving our brothers, loving our sisters. And when those people gathered themselves together, the first thing they did was they gave away their belongings. Do you remember that? Talks about that in the covenant word, the new Testament. And especially those in the congregations where Paul went to and those other areas where Peter went to, they gave away their belongings. meaning that they gave their excesses to help others that needed it, that it was the right thing to do, and they felt it. That's part of overcoming that pride, that act of doing it, just do it. Don't say it, just do it. Actually, depriving yourself of something is an act that's blessed, in that fasting from focus on money and fasting from overeating and eating lots of things we shouldn't be eating or drinking things we shouldn't be drinking that are unhealthy for us. Fasting is important. Dee and I know that is such an important aspect of our lives. Fasting from things in the world, a permanent fast on the things that are toxic. Today is the last day of unleavened bread if you're keeping to the Enoch calendar that we have on the website as far as that goes. Today would be the last day of unleavened bread. Getting that leavening out and not having leavening, spiritual leavening that we talked about last week, is part of what we do in that sort of fasting way. That depriving ourselves of what the world thinks is important to have, we get all that leavening out. And that deprivation is good, because then you're filling your heart with something else, love. So when other churches keep the covenant and they think they're keeping the covenant, they're really not. When they don't treat the name importantly, they let the leavening of the world come in and give them these false names. In Genesis, the very beginning of Genesis, you know, about creating the heavens and the earth and all that is in them, right? That act of creation was a display of exactly the seven parts of this physical life since man was created that we're going through. 6 days, and then the seventh he rested. Well, it's been 6,000 years, and we're now entering into that seventh part, that thousand-year reign that's going to be coming when Master creates it here on earth. And it's going to be a time of rest after that tribulation. But you need to know who he is. You need to know why he is. And that's where the covenant comes in and the great name comes in. And the scriptures say, I am that I am. The letter I is actually a Greek letter that before Greeks used the letter I, it was the letter Y. The progression was Y to I and then to J. That's why it went from Yahuwah, which was Yahuwah Savior, which then was abbreviated to Yahuwah Savior or Yahushua, went from Yahushua without the consonants and vowels and understanding the basics of things in Hebrew, became a translation among the Greeks that turned it to Iesus, that turned it into Jesus. So there was this progression, downward spiral of the great name that occurred. I am that I am. You look at that Y, or the I being the Yod, and then you look at M, the understanding of that word as an ah or an expression, and that, the word that, is, it means who or whosoever is. And then, of course, M being the last of I am that I am, you have the name of Yahuwah right there, supernaturally, in that statement of I am that I am. We also know the letters Yod Heh Wah Heh, YHWH. We know the A precedes the H. We know the U precedes the W in English today. But a W is a double U. So we just, instead of having two U's in the name of Yahuwah, we have a U and a W. Yod Heh Wah Heh. Because the Wah is more of the W comes directly from that Wah. So that's why we do it that way. Although I don't think it would be entirely incorrect to have a UU, but because we do speak English and because we do see how the word, and we're not Hebrews anymore, right? We're not writing the ancient Hebrew in the ancient Hebrew. We're writing in English. Yahuwah, Y-A-H-U-W-A-H. Very straightforward, very simple, very unconvoluted, but the importance of the name is the second part of something important that the churches minimize. They say it's not important. They'll keep to the Zeus name, and the people are so blinded they can't see it. The fact that you can see this is so unbelievably amazing that you don't have a clue how amazing you are, or it is. We're nothing, but what's amazing is what Yahuwah gives to you that the world cannot see. And it is an amazing thing that you know the importance of the covenant. You know the importance of the name. You know what the good news hope is, that you can see that, and that you can get out all this other leavening, and that you can stay away from being cultically mind controlled by all these groups who love to put yokes on you and make you tread out through their garden or their pasture or their farm in their way and ways and road. That you can break away from that is something amazing. And if you stop and think about that and ponder that for a moment, why were you given this gift? You right now, listening and agreeing and understanding with these basic three things. Why were you given this gift? Because you were known before the very foundation of the earth. He knew you. He created all of this just for you. And he knew that you would be the one. He knew that that those people that came from the original people of Yahuwah, who he loved so much at that time, he still loves them all too, but they've gone away. And the scriptures talk about they're done. And there'll be some in the latter days that are going to repent. But for the most part, it was just some of those basic early ones that he developed that he had that great love for as his people. And they still are his people. And they still are his original people. And they are the reason that he did all of this. But so are you. Because he knew there would be a following away from that bloodline, and that the Gentiles would then be allowed to come in, certain Gentiles. But you were selected to be one of those people. You're not valued any less, just so you know. You're not valued any less than Abraham or Moshe, any less than Jeremiah or Isaiah or Daniel or Dawid, King David. You're not valued any less than any of the 12 disciples. We all have our part. And you were chosen from before the world was ever formed. He knew that all this would be done so that you could see this and know this. You could praise Yahuwah and would praise Yahuwah by your actions, by your heart, and by your activities. Even though the camel that is the world are not going to make it for the most part through that eye of a needle. You. And so, Do you praise Yahuwah for that? Many have been called, but few are chosen. And you are chosen to be able to see these things. And highly favored are you, and blessed are you, because you said, "This matters to me." You don't have an attitude of, "Why the covenant?" Almost every week, Daniel, every week it seems, you're always talking about the covenant, or you're declaring the name of Yahuwah, or you're talking about, you know, the saving rapture, the good news, and the kingdom to come. Why is it every week you talk about those things? Because that is what all we're supposed to talk about. Because that is what is in our DNA. Turn now to 2 Esdras chapter 1 if you have it. If not, no worries. The second book of the prophet Esdras, the son of Sarias, the son of Azarias, the son of Helkias, the son of Sedemias, the son of Sadok, the son of Achitob, the son of Achaeus, the son of Phinehas, the son of Eli, the son of Amarias, the son of Azi, the son of Merimoth, the son and spake unto thee of Baroth, the son of Abisael, the son of Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, of the tribe of Levi, which was captive in the land of the Medes in the reign of Artaxerxes, king of the Persians. So now we have an idea of when this was. About 400 years, I think, before Master. And the word of Yahuwah came unto me, saying, "Go thy way, show my people their sinful deeds and their children, their wickedness, which they have done against me, that they may tell their children's children." because the sins of their fathers are increased in them, for they have forgotten me and have offered unto strange gods. See, right away, this is what the covenant says at the very beginning, we're warned against doing. And so why does Yahuwah have Esdras give this warning? Why does he want to tell him something to declare? Because there are many who are called, and those who he has chosen, who he has known from the very beginning, there's a catalyst for many of us that needs to happen. There's a spark. And there are a couple of people out there who I know by name and love greatly. I don't agree with them in many ways about certain things. But I learned the name of Yahuwah and the importance of covenant from them. So very dear to my heart. But they were the spark. They were the catalyst. They were the Esdras, if you will. And you and I are to be doing and not holding back the good news and the way and the name. Because when you talk to somebody and you give them a little bit and they say, oh, that's interesting. Well, tell me more. You are the spark that may be the spark that helps them to actually be that light of Yahuwah. It's not for nothing that he tells Esdras to declare these things for future generations. And so strange gods and sin being increased is something that we see today. We're so sinful. People that go to church have no clue how much paganism is wrapped up in their daily activities. And even in the church that they belong to, their Zeus gods and their idol worship. It says in verse 7, am not I even he that brought them out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage? But they have provoked me unto wrath and despised my counsels. That's the first thing that the covenant declares, that he takes us out of bondage, and he took us out of Mitzrayim. He took us out physically, and he takes us out today spiritually, right, brothers and sisters? Verse 8, pull thou off then the hair of thy head, cast all evil upon them, for they have not been obedient unto my law, but it is a rebellious people. He's talking about the covenant word. Again, a prophet declaring the covenant word. How long shall I forbear them, into whom I have done so much good? Many kings have I destroyed for their sakes. Pharaoh with his servants and all his power have I smitten down. All the nations have I destroyed before them. And in the east I have scattered the people of two provinces, even of Tyrus and of Sidon, and have slain all their enemies. Speak thou therefore unto them, says Yahuwah. I led you through the sea, and in the beginning I gave you a large and safe passage. I gave you Moses for a leader, and Aaron for a priest. I gave you light in a pillar of fire, and great wonders have I done among you. Yet have ye forgotten me, says Yahuwah. How is it that the churches have forgotten him? Because they don't keep his covenant. And keeping covenant is the thing that Master said we have to do if we want eternal salvation. And yet the people don't want to keep covenant. So they're going to continue to fight having to keep it. They fight keeping covenant. So therefore they cling to those who tickle their ears because they don't want to do covenant keeping. It's very satanic. Again, the camel and the eye of the needle, the wave and the drop. So thus says Yahuwah. The quails were as a token to you. I gave you tents for your safeguard. Nevertheless, he murmured there. In other words, I gave you food to eat, and you had coverings over your head, but it wasn't good enough, and you wanted more. Instead of realizing that you're to be separate from the world anyway, and that this is just a moment of passing from this sinful life into something absolutely unbelievable, but we're so nearsighted. We just can't see the forest from the trees. We can't look down the road. He says, verse 16, and triumph not in my name for the destruction of your enemies, but ever to this day do ye yet murmur. In other words, my name, that powerful thing that protects you. You know, I don't know if you know this, brothers and sisters, but in the temple of Yahuwah, which you now are, they would keep the Ark of the Covenant, which contained the Ten Commandments, right? And also the bread of the manna that came down. And Aaron's he had a little rod that he that was in there as well. But the covenant, it was a guarded place. It was walls within a wall. There was only one priest allowed to go in there. And that priest would also be the only place you would declare Yahuwah's great name, later on in life when they started making it so that nobody could have that privilege, but just the highest priest. But you see, brothers and sisters, that covenant and that Ark of the Covenant that they would proceed out in front of them in battle that protected them, which contained Yahuwah's great name, you now have that covenant. He protects you. The only thing that erodes that protection is you doing bad. If you get the bad out, then you become a full, clean temple of Yahuwah with the Ark of the Covenant within you, with His great name within you, with His bread of life, His manna within you. And you have that protection and that blessing. But if you decide, none of this is going to be important enough to me, then you're not going to have that protection. You're not going to have that blessing. Sin is constantly something we have to fight against so that full armor of Yahuwah can be put upon us and we can be safeguarded just like Yahuwah did in verse 15. But nevertheless, he murmured there. He said, you still complain. You don't have enough. 16, and triumph, not in my name for the destruction of your enemies, but ever to this day do ye yet murmur. I just have to read that again. My name, the importance of the name. Oh, the name's not important. Really? It was a protection for the people in war and everything. Verse 17, where are the benefits that I have done for you? When ye were hungry and thirsty in the wilderness, did ye not cry out unto me, saying, why hast thou brought us into this wilderness to kill us? It had been better for us to have served the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. See, they didn't have as much as they used to have. And Yahuwah knew it, but that was part of the stretching that needed to occur too. There was a lot of reasons for all this. It was an end result of course, leaving your homes that you've had for hundreds of years there in Egypt. But then it was also an end result of giving up all of that and saying what's most important is, but see, they were more worried and focused about being saved. They didn't really care truly about pleasing Yahuwah. And it seems the world is more focused on their salvation rather than the fact that, you know what, that's just an end result of the fact that you should be doing things to please our Almighty, to be thankful to Him. You don't know if you're going to be saved or not, and it doesn't matter, frankly. You should be thankful for your life right now and to Him right now that made you, and the basics and the simplicity of that. And all the other things, all the mansions and all the, oh, we're going to get this and oh, we're going to have that and oh, we're going to live forever and oh, everything's going to be perfect. And that's all, there's times when we focus on that, but that's not what this is all about. Your walk right now is to say, Father, no matter what, I am so grateful to serve you, to be with you, to be with Master, to be with your loving Ruach Yahuwah. So he says, verse 19, then I had pity on your mournings and gave you manna to eat. So you did eat angel's bread. And when you were thirsty, did I not cleave the rock and waters flowed out to your fill? For the heat, I covered you with the leaves of the trees. By the way, brothers and sisters, I believe that there's different levels of heaven. There's different places of Shamayim, that there's a heaven in a dimension within our own firmament, within our own sky. When you look up in the sky, there really is a dimension of heaven right there. And I believe when he says that manna is this angel's bread, I really do believe it. I actually do believe too that just because the future's coming doesn't mean we will not be eating and enjoying food. How wonderful food is. I love to cook. It's my passion in life is cooking. And so I love to think that there's a future for us, culinarily speaking, because I think it's just one of the greatest blessings that there is, if not the greatest earthly blessing is food. It can be anyway, unless we don't, treat it as such. But he says he gave that. He goes, when you're thirsty, did I not cleave the rock and waters flowed out to your fill? For the heat, I covered you with leaves of the trees. I divided among you a fruitful land. I cast out the Canaanites, Perizzites, and Philistines before you. What shall I yet do more for you, says Yahuwah? And he goes on. He says, thus says Yahuwah, when you were in the wilderness in the river, the Amorites, being athirst and blaspheming my name, I gave you not fire for your blasphemies, but cast a tree in the water and made the river sweet. See, he says, you didn't treat my name as important yet again. Covenant name, covenant name. Not just for the Hebrews then. These things are for all time. Eternal covenant, the word says. He says, what shall I do unto thee, Jacob, and thou, Yehuda? Wouldst thou not obey me? I will turn me to other nations. And unto those I will give my name, that they will keep my statutes. See, the Hebrews, they just would not. Over and over and over, all these books of the scriptures, the one thing that they tell you, did you keep covenant? If you didn't, then you lost blessings. Did you keep covenant? And you did, then you gained blessings. Did you keep my name? And you did, then you got blessings. If you didn't keep my name, you lost my blessings. Do the churches teach that today? No. He says it right here in verse 24. He goes, I'll turn to the other nations. That's you. That's the Gentiles. He says, I'll give them my name. You have his name. He's seen to it. You don't have to doubt it. And you'll keep my statutes, my covenant words. Yes, we do. He says, seeing ye have forsaken me, I will forsake you also when you desire me to be gracious unto you or give you my Canaan. I shall not have no mercy upon you. Whensoever ye shall call upon me, I will not hear you. For ye have defiled your hands with blood, and your feet are swift to commit manslaughter. All the way down to this very day, brothers and sisters, the Pharisees and the bloodlined people of Yahuwah, and most of the world who are not even of the bloodlines, they forsake Yahuwah, but specifically these are the bloodline. They forsake his name, and they forsake his covenant. They make other things more important. And they make pride more important. They remove the love, which is the main ingredient that Master taught. He says that I'm not going to have any mercy upon you. So there are going to be those that are going to go all the way through and have the last 6,000 years into the tribulation and through the tribulation and through unspeakable hell on earth. And some may, at the very end, be gleamed out because they'll finally change. Some of them. Very few. He says, ye have not, as it were, forsaken me, but your own selves, says Yahuwah. He goes, so you know what? When you forsake me, you don't really forsake me. You forsake yourself. You ruin it for yourself. So Yahuwah says further, have I not prayed you as a father, his sons, as a mother, his daughters, and a nurse, her young babes, that ye would be my people and I should be your Eloah? That ye would be my children and I should be your father. I gathered you together as a hen gathered her chickens under her wings. But now what shall I do unto you? I will cast you out from my face. And when ye offer unto me, I will turn my face from you. So their burnt offerings and stuff didn't mean a thing. Even all the way back when 400 years before Master, this was stated. He goes, for your solemn feast days? He goes, I'll turn my face from you. For your new moons? I'll turn my face from you. And your circumcision? Have I forsaken? He says, all this stuff doesn't mean anything to me. Because you don't keep my name and you don't keep my covenant, which are the two things I really want you to do. Not all this other stuff that you make more important. See, that was the stuff that they... Well, you know, we've talked about that so much, but verse 32, I sent unto you my servants, the prophets, whom ye have taken and slain and torn their bodies in pieces, whose blood I will require of your hands, says Yahuwah. Thus says Almighty Yahuwah, your house is desolate. I will cast you out as the wind doth stubble. Your children shall not be fruitful, for they have despised my commandments and done the thing that is an evil before me. Your houses will I give to a people that shall come, which not having heard of me, yet shall believe me, to whom I have shown no signs, yet they shall do that I have commanded them. That's you, brothers and sisters. That's you. You're his children. He says, they have seen no prophets, yet they shall call their sins to remembrance and acknowledge them. In other words, repentance is important to his people. I take to witness the Canaan of the people to come, whose little ones rejoice in gladness. And though they have not seen me with bodily eyes, yet in spirit they believe the thing that I say. That's what you do. And now, brother, behold what glory, and see the people that I that come from the east, unto whom I will give for leaders Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Osias, Amos, Micaiah, Joel, Obadiah, Jonas, Nahum, Habakkuk, Sophonius, Agabus, Zachary, Malachi, which is called also a Malachi of Yahuwah. Thus says Yahuwah, chapter 2, I brought this people out of bondage, and I gave them my commandments, my manservants, the prophets, whom they would not hear, but despised my counsels. The mother that bare them said unto them, go your way, ye children, for I am a widow and forsaken. I brought you up with gladness, but ye with sorrow and heaviness have I lost you, for ye have sinned before Yahuwah, and done that thing that is evil before me. But what shall I now do unto you? I am a widow and forsaken. Go your way, O my children, and ask mercy of Yahuwah. As for me, O Father, I call upon thee for a witness over the mother of these children which would not keep my covenant, that thou bring them to confusion and their mother to spoil, that there may be no offspring in them. See, not keeping the covenant word. Let them be scattered abroad among the heathen. Let their names be put out of the earth, for they have despised my covenant. Woe be unto thee, Asher, thou that hidest under the unrighteous in thee. O thou wicked people, remember what I did unto Sodom and Gomorrah, whose land lieth in clods of pitch and heaps of ashes. Even so also will I do unto them that hear me not, saith Almighty Yahuwah. You think those stories are important to know about Sodom and Gomorrah? Foolish ones today look at all this as just stories. And why? Because after all, the churches don't even teach this properly. So why should they believe any of it? See how the slippery slope of not just what the name was, but what it became? How everything was eroded? How the understanding of covenant became eroded as to other laws and other things? And translations of translations become mistranslated in the basics of things, or in the meat of what's being said. You know the truth of things. If you're reading the word, you get it. Man will complicate everything and make people reprobate in their hearts to get them to believe things the way that they want you to believe it, instead of simply looking at the basics of things. And that's why I say the simplicity of scriptures is the most important thing. It simply states, keep covenant. It simply states, keep the name Yahuwah set apart. It simply states, declare the good news of the kingdom, the saving way of things. And that's it. Have love among yourselves. So verse 10, thus says Yahuwah unto Esdras, tell my people that I will give them the kingdom of Jerusalem, which I would have given unto Yasarah. Their glory also will I take unto me, and give these everlasting tabernacles which I had prepared for them. They shall have the tree of life for an ointment of sweet savor. They shall neither labor nor be weary. Go, and ye shall receive. Pray for a few days unto you, that they may be shortened. The kingdom is already prepared for you. Watch. Okay? This is, friends, the good news of the kingdom right here. We begin to see the flavor in Esdras. Okay, covenant. Okay, importance of name. Ah, here we go with kingdom. Here we go. Verse 14, take heaven and earth to witness, for I have broken the evil in pieces and created the good, for I live, says Yahuwah. Mother, embrace thy children and bring them up with gladness. Make their feet as fast as a pillar, for I have chosen thee, says Yahuwah. And those that be dead will I raise up again from their places and bring them out of the graves, for I have known my name in Yasarah. Fear not, though mother of the children, for I have chosen thee, says Yahuwah. For thy help will I send my servants Esau and Jeremiah, after whose counsel I have sanctified and prepared for thee 12 trees laden with diverse fruits. Now, brothers and sisters, we have on our webpage, praiseyahuwah.com, under the library is the Praise Yahuwah Scriptures, and it's basically a compilation of different Bibles, but it's not as a plagiarism, but it is information from various Bibles. And the Scriptures are the Scriptures. Nobody can own the Word of Yahuwah. You can own a specific translation, but we said no. In this case, this is not going to be a specific Bible that goes to financially benefit other people. This is going to be simply the Word of Yahuwah, and it's the edition of the 12 fruits, the 12 fruits edition. And why? Because they changed the 12 fruits and they took them out. And there's evidence in other ancient Bibles of 12 fruits in Galatians, which all the Bibles of today don't have. And Revelation 22, 1 and 2, which is highlighted there, and you can download this and you can print it. You just can't sell it, can't trade it for financial gain or anything like that. You can convert it into other electronic media, but it's a PDF. It can be converted easily into Mobi or Kindle. And anyway, I've got highlighted there, I make the fruits and the covenant, both covenant words in the earlier part of the New Old Testament is highlighted with the page titled, so that the covenant and the fruits are in your face. And the names in it are there to praise Yahuwah with the Yah, the U, the Ah, because we love him so much and because that was the original way of his people. And everything in there may not be perfect. All the names have been bastardized. Brothers and sisters, all the names have been changed. There's not one version, not one. And anybody that says that their version is a true version is a liar, because it's all been changed. But this is the best that through my years of understanding, this is the best that I've been able to have. And I wanted to have this for you presented there so that you could have this translation for yourself. I believe it's the best one that there is and the most enjoyable to read. And it just feels clean and it feels right. And we praise Yahuwah. So here in Esdras verse 18, which says that he prepared 12 trees laden with diverse fruit. That's because there's 12 fruits, brothers and sisters, just like Revelation 22, 1 and 2 declares as a second witness. It denies what the Bibles of today say the 12 fruits are in Galatians 5 as being only 9, truly only 6, because 3 of them are synonyms. Isn't that interesting? Only half of the 12 fruits are really listed in all the current Bibles of today. But Revelation 22, 1 and 2 says that there's 12 fruits, a fruit for every month. And then here in Esdras chapter 18, another witness to 12 fruits. 12 trees laden with diverse fruits. Each tree has its own fruit. There are 12 fruits. This is another witness to 12 fruits, a second witness. And I came upon this the other day. And I praised Yahuwah so greatly. And where I first heard about 12 fruits from a man who said he had gotten a Bible that they dug up or something, and I never found evidence of anything, so I couldn't swear to it, if you will, as a witness, right? Because there was no evidence, so I didn't know where it came other than that he said it was there. That's where I first heard that there was this 12 fruits. But then I found out in one day reading the Wycliffe, I think it's 1394 translation, and it had the 12 fruits there, and my jaw dropped. Something told me, look at that and see if it has the 12 fruits. I did, and I saw it, and I could see what the 12 fruits actually were. It spelled them all out. It was different from anything I had ever read. And so Revelation 22, 1 and 2, and now Esdras, In this verse 18, as is another witness. So praise Yahuwah for that, brothers and sisters. And this came right after we put together and we were able to display this translation of the 12 fruits. Praise Yahuwah scriptures. And I know that that was something that Yahuwah allowed me to see. And sometimes I'll read things because I've read Esdras before and it just doesn't, certain things don't sink in. Then all of a sudden he turns a light on. You can read books of the Bible, brothers and sisters, dozens and dozens and dozens of times, but you have never read the scriptures enough because he has not revealed in you yet what he's going to reveal in you from those words that you're reading. So every time you read the scriptures, you should be reading in anticipation that he's going to bring you things that you've never seen before, because he does and he will. Verse 19, and as many fountains flowing with milk and honey, seven mighty mountains whereupon there grow roses and lilies, whereby I will fill thy children with joy. Do right to the widow, judge for the fatherless, give to the poor, defend the orphan, clothe the naked, heal the broken and the weak. Laugh not a lame man to scorn. Defend the maimed. Let the blind man come into the sight of my clearness. See, he's teaching us those fruits of how we're to be. Be more loving. Be more giving. Don't take, 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 but give. He says, keep the old and the young within thy walls. Wheresoever thou findest the dead. And by the way, this is something that I've thought about. Even eventually, Dee and I, we've been thinking about ways that we could help old and young. And I think that as Yahweh's people, we should be thinking in terms of that. The most needy, how can we help them? What can we do? We always are going to have more than other people. No matter what our financial situation, we have things. It just is a matter of, are we able to get out of our prideful and selfish ways. Verse 23, wheresoever thou findest the dead, take them and bury them, and I will give thee the first place in my resurrection. Abide still, O my people. Take thy rest, for thy quietness still come. Nourish thy children, O thou good nurse. Establish their feet. As for the servants whom I have given thee, there shall not one of them perish. For I will require them from among thy number. Be not weary, for when the day of trouble, now I want you to recognize what we're about to say, that Yahuwah has declared, be not weary, for when the day of trouble and heaviness cometh, others shall weep and be sorrowful, but thou shalt be merry and have abundance. Now, why is that? Because you are going to be going through the horrible things that are going to happen, or because he's going to save you? Because the good news of the kingdom is that you will have abundance. How can you be merry if people are dying all around you, if you're stepping over dead bodies? You can't. You'll be merry. You will have abundance because you will be taken out of this situation. He says, the heathen shall envy thee, but they shall be able to do nothing against thee, says Yahuwah. Yeah, you won't even be here. Why? Verse 29, my hands will cover thee so that thy children shall see, who shall not see hell. Now, you know, I worry about my children. And so when I see this and I read this, it's such a blessing. And to know that he's says, I'm going to look out for your kids. Just like he looked out for Noah's children. Remember that? So he looks out for family. He appreciates family. What is one of the things that Master did when he knew he was right before he was going to give up his life, right before he was going to be taken? He looks over at Yahuwah Khanah and he says, you know, he takes him and he puts his hand in her hand or, you know, on her or whatever and says, this is your mother. You take care of my mom. That's what he said, basically. He says, Yahuwah Khanah and John, you're going to take care of my mom now. See, that's the way he is. Take care of family. And we need to be more like that. Who of us would turn away a family member? Now, be careful. There are people who will try to use you. They'll try to claim they're family, but they're really not family. Their actions, their works, their walk, and their way demonstrates they have a true heart for Yahuwah, that they are doing Yahuwah's will, and that they are your family. You'll know who your family is. And if there's any doubt in your mind, then they're probably not family. Not yet, anyway. So be careful. Just like your own mother and your own sister and your own brother and your own children, you know who your family is. We know who our family in Yahuwah is. And we have each other's backs. And that's the way we are. It says, be joyful, O thou mother, with thy children, for I will deliver thee, says Yahuwah. What does it mean to deliver? It means to take out, to gather, to take out, to remove, to save. This is, remember thy children that sleep. Now he's talking about those that have died. He's not, so he's not talking about those who have passed away, where we already know there's a hope and there's a saving and there's a resurrection and there's all this stuff, like a lot of different churches teach. That's what he's about to talk about now, those who have fallen asleep in death. He's talking previously to this about those who are alive. Do you see the difference? Remember thy children that sleep, for I shall bring them out of the sides of the earth and show mercy unto them. For I am merciful, says Yahuwah. Embrace thy children until I come and show mercy unto them, for my wells run over and my canon shall not fail. I, Esdras, received a charge of Yahuwah upon the mountain of Oreb, that I should go unto Yasarel. But when I came unto them, they set me at naught and despised the commandments of Yahuwah. And therefore I say to you, O heathen, that hear and understand, look for your shepherd. He shall give you everlasting rest, for he is nigh at hand, that shall come in the end of the world. Be ready to the reward of the kingdom, for the everlasting light shall shine upon you evermore. See, be ready. It's coming. Flee the shadow of this world. Receive the joyfulness of your glory. I testify my Savior openly. Brothers and sisters, fleeing the shadow of the world means getting the leavening out, getting rid of it, stopping the badness of the world, the pollution of the world. 37, oh, receive the gift that is given you and be glad. Give thanks unto him that hath led you to the heavenly kingdom. Arise up and stand. See? Arise up and stand. Behold the number of those that be sealed in the feast of Yahuwah. Brothers and sisters, this is the wedding feast of those who are raptured. Before the great, who are being saved before the horrible things of the world are to occur. Against all those that will not have that protection and blessing and saving because of the covenant and because of the great name. And you're going to be at a feast. And I believe it's going to be a real feast. A feast like you have never known. Spiritual, yes, but also I believe in a very literal way. And I could be wrong on that, but I just want to believe that. Don't you? So receive that heavenly gift. And arise and ascend, you know, go up and be at that feast and be sealed. Remember what it says about those of Izzy, seals on the forehead. This is which are departed from the shadow of the world. Oh, really? Departed? You mean those that arise, that go up, are departing? Yes. And leaving the bad air, the badness, leaving the world, leaving the dirt and the filth. You're going to have joy and gladness and abundance. And you're going to have it immediately. When he takes you, you're going to be out of here. So let's do everything we can to be part of that, right? Take thy number. Oh, no. First, before that, it says, and have received the glorious garments of Yahuwah. Remember the robes, putting on the white robes and the crowns? It says, take thy number, O Zion, and shut up those of thine that are clothed in white, which have fulfilled the law of Yahuwah. So, those that are numbered, you, those that he's chosen, you, those that keep his covenant, those that keep his name, he says, shut them up. In other words, protect them. Take them out. Put them in something that I have created. The scriptures puts it in various ways, mansions and different things. He says, put these white robes on them. Why? They have fulfilled the law of Yahuwah. Think about what it means in the covenant. To fulfill it in every way. How are you removing gods or Elohim before your face? In every way, how do you not manufacture or be part of the contaminations of this world? How do you get rid of the leavening of this world, as in the second commandment? In every way, how do you treat his name, Yahuwah, as being so important? In every way, how do you look to Shabbat, the wonderful aspect of this day for Dee and I? Today is our Shabbat day, because we will work on the other days, the other 6 days. And so how are we blessed, and does he bless us, and what do we do to be closer to him on that day? In every way, how do you honor your parents by walking in Yahuwah? In every way, how do you be faithful and not commit adultery? In every way, how do you be honest and not steal? In other words, keeping the 12 fruits. In every way, how do you not give a false testimony and not lie, but speak these truths that are inconvenient for people to hear? And you're not going to gain any friends, brothers and sisters. You're not going to have any friends. Your friends will eventually leave you. I don't have any friends except those that are in Yahuwah. All your friends of the world, all the people that you've known your whole life, and even family members, they're not going to want to have anything to do with you because of it. Because when you speak truth, they don't want to hear it. They don't want to be part of it. They don't want to get out from what they're in. So we won't hold back. In every way, don't lust after material things or what your neighbor has or all the benefits of the world, but simply love one another. So he says, this is the people. These are the ones that are clothed in white, which have fulfilled in every way, you see, the law of Yahuwah. The number of thy children, verse 41, whom thou longest for, is fulfilled. Beseech the power of Yahuwah that thy people, which have been called from the beginning, may be hallowed. I, Ezra, saw upon the Mount Zion a great people whom I could not number, and they all praised Yahuwah with songs. Hallelujah. And in the midst of them, there was a young man of high stature, taller than all the rest. And upon every one of their heads, he set crowns and was more exalted, which I marveled at greatly. This is the crowning ceremony, brothers and sisters, that occurs, because you will be given crowns, white robes. You'll be at a big meal with Master. He says, so I asked the angel, and I said, sir, what are these? Remember, Revelation said, you know, who are all these people? Remember that? There was that question. He says, sir, what are all these? And he says to me, these be they that have put off the mortal clothing and put on the immortal and have confessed the name of Yahuwah. Now they are crowned and receive palms. Then said I unto the angel, what young person is it that crowneth them all and give them palms in their hands? So he answered and said to me, it is the Son of Yahuwah, whom they have confessed in the world. Then began I greatly to commend them that stood so stiffly for the name of Yahuwah. Then the angel said unto me, go thy way and tell my people what manner of things and how great wonders of Yahuwah Eloah Ya'am, thou hast seen. Now, brothers, sisters, Esdras, I'm going to read that statement one more time. Then I began, I greatly commended them that stood so stiffly for the name of Yahuwah. Now, brothers and sisters, he's looking at you right now, all of you hearing this broadcast in the recording or listening live. He actually knows who you are right now. He's looking at you right now, sister, brother. He's looking at you right now, and he says, I commend you for standing so stiffly for the name of Yahuwah. In other words, making the name of Yahuwah matter. It was the one thing that this website, which is your website, by the way, praiseyahuwah.com is not Denia's website. Please don't look at it as Danny Ardia's website. It's your website. In fact, we always want your feedback. And we want to, if you ever have any ideas about the website, or you, because we just redid the whole thing, because we have taken ideas from others who have recommended and different things. And so this website was named when we thought, well, what? Let's do a website to you know, to praise Yahuwah. You know, this was many years ago, decade ago, whatever it was, now over. And he says, let's get a website to praise Yahuwah. What do we call it? You know, there's all these names, all these things we could call it, the kingdom of this and the message of that. And, you know, it's just all kinds of little catchphrases. What do we call it? The main thing we need it to do is praise Yahuwah. What do we call this website? And we said, well, we gotta praise Yahuwah. That, what else could it possibly be but praise Yahuwah? And another brother, that owned the name to yahoo.com as well, which we have forwarded to our a website. So when you type in yahoo, it just automatically comes to praiseyahoo.com. And we have Kingdom of Yah as well, which goes to the praiseyahoo.com. And so, but we do this so that people know that this is what we're all about, brothers and sisters. And these first two chapters of Esdras are absolutely amazing because they declare the importance of praising Yahuwah. And you and I are going to be known for stiffly standing by the name of Yahuwah and praising the name and making the name matter. And there's different ways that people spell Yahuwah. But brothers and sisters, why do we use this name? Well, for real reasons, for actual, and my knowledge of Hebrew is limited. I'm a child, in the understanding of Hebrew, but I understand enough to know the truth of the importance of the, vowels being before the consonants. And the same vowel is before the H at the beginning and the end. I am that I am, right? And the UW is because it's a double U, and which was originally a wa, but it has a vowel before it. So it's a seven-letter word, and it's a seven-letter word not by accident. Every single thing Yahuwah does, he does in sevens, brothers and sisters, and keep that in mind when you're looking at fruit. Just like every prophet declares three things, the name, the covenant, and the kingdom coming, kingdom. And so when you look at the name of Yahuwah, Y-A-H-U-W-A-H, Yahuwah put it in me early on as a young man, as a little boy, I knew that the name wasn't Jehovah, or I knew that Jehovah wasn't right, because as a Jehovah's Witness, I knew that the great name was Yod-Heh-Wah-Heh. They taught me that. So I said, well, if the name is YHWH, then what is this Jehovah stuff? And I'm a little kid, right? Why are they? And so I used to try to sound it out. Yahuwah. Isn't that something? I don't see myself. I see a little kid when I look back at that whippersnapper who got into a lot of trouble. And it was pretty deceptive. You had to be deceptive when you grew up in a cult, because if you wanted to get away with all the things you wanted to do, you had to learn to, like every other kid that was in it, they all learned how to do things deceptively. Very sad, isn't it? Because we didn't have the true love of the Almighty. Let's see. And you saw things that weren't right and, you know, whatever. It's a bad foundation. Not all religions are the same, so, you know, not one. I'm not going to endorse one over the other, because none of them can be endorsed. But I knew the name of Yahuwah was so important, so Yahuwah raised me up and he said, Denia, you are going to praise my name. Now, I didn't hear a voice, right? I just look at the result of everything, how it happened and what happened and the root of how it happened. And I see it all the heartache that I've gone through in my life, the death of loved ones, the divorce and the taking away of family and children, and the pain of life and the things that I did that were wrong, the things not just that others did around me that I always would blame, but the things that I should have been also looking at within myself, which was a catalyst for also things that were bad that happened to me. See, the sins are passed on when we sin. But throughout all that, I knew the truth, that there was something there. And I had a mind, what people would call you a conspiracy theorist mind. That's why they don't like people that look into things too deeply. The Jehovah's Witnesses religion don't want you to look into things too deeply either. Neither does the governments of the world and the controlling factions of the world and even other religions of this world. They don't want you to look at things outside the box and examine things, because then you might have your eyes open to things. But I knew that there was something in that name. And so we learned about the great name of Yahuwah when I saw it for the very first time. It hit me like a car accident and it blew my mind. I'd heard all these other names, but I was like, that's the name. I know that's the name. That's it. And I, for the longest time, I kind of even felt like, you know, should I tell people all these feelings that I have? Because I kind of seem a little zealous for the name. But you know, the more I've read scriptures, I realize that's because that's what I'm supposed to be doing. That's what you're supposed to have in your heart, is a zeal and a love for that name. Rejoicing in the name. The first thing when you pray is to let his name be set apart. Let his name be known throughout the whole world. And let his kingdom come. You see, these three things, the covenant with his name and the coming kingdom, the coming good news, the coming rapture and the saving and the gathering and the white robing and the crowns and the meal and the mansions and all this stuff, which is all great, well and good. We just want to be with Master, but all these things are happening and you're going to be in it. Brothers and sisters, overcome. Get out of the badness of this world. These churches and these groups, there's a force of evil that is hurting you. Remove it. Cling to that which is pure and good. Now you are the temple of Yahuwah. First learn his word yourself, away from all these religions. That's what I had to do. I had to get out of them. Even the group I originally was with, where I learned the name of Yahuwah. And another guy that's a messianic that I heard also simultaneously heard the name of Yahuwah spoken for the first time. They believe all these. They've got a lot of good stuff because there is covenant there. But then there's all this other stuff that goes outside of the basic simplicity of the word, which unfortunately does not allow you or afford you to be able to fully develop an understanding and a teaching that Yahuwah will give you directly. You are not to need another man or woman for your salvation. You are a temple of Yahuwah that is directly connected to him, and Ruach Yahuwah will absolutely not forsake you. He will give you his active energy and light so that you can see things that you need to see. The scriptures call the Ruach Yahuwah a him, and it also calls him an intercessor. Master is also an intercessor and a mediator to Yahuwah. Did you know that you have two fellas going to bat for you? Two beings making intercession for you, not just one, two. The scriptures declare it in several places. And Yahuwah the Father, who they plead with, they on your behalf. Appreciate that, brothers and sisters, because you don't know. I am guilty in my life of looking at the Ruach of Yahuwah in the way that I was raised. That the Holy Spirit, quote unquote, which by the way, the word holy is not a set apart word. It's from the holly tree where they used to do holly water and do holly baptisms of children. And all kinds of pagan practices that go way back. Holy and holly are the same thing. That's why it's Hollywood. Holy wood. The Holy Spirit, I understood it as just a tool of force from Almighty. I didn't know that the set-apart Ruach of Yahuwah, who is named Yahuwah by name in Scripture, that that is an actual Him. It says Him, and it's an actual being. Until I came to know Yahuwah and read His Word and started realizing things. So we do have Father, and we do have the Ruach, which is, and we can't understand how it is, but the Ruach is also part of the Almighty Father. Different than the Son, who He created, who is a part of Yahuwah at His right hand, but not in the same way that the Ruach is. And these things are very complicated because we are a 3D, three-dimensional world, not spirit dimension. We're analog in a digital, we're digital beings or analog beings in a digital spectrum, if you will. So it's hard for us to wrap our heads around things. And the Scripture says, don't worry. You know, these things are so beyond you right now. You know, you're going to learn a lot more later. So just have faith in it. So Yahuwah, the Father and the Son and the set apart Ruach that we baptize in the name of, they all share the same name. So we baptize in the name of all three, which are Yahuwah. We come to love that name and those four letters, YHWH, Yod Heh Wah Heh, and the understanding of why there's an A before both H's and a U before the W. It's basic stuff. Now we can work to change it. And there was a group that worked to change the name of Yahuwah a little bit so they could be different. But it didn't resonate with me because I didn't like six letters, because I know Yahuwah's name is seven letters, and I know He does all in seven. So brothers and sisters, praise Yahuwah, your website, use the tools that we put on there. We're going to further read on another day in the book of Esdras, because it's a great book, but I don't want to get too far carried into it. Over and over and over, Esdras will declare what happens in the Great Tribulation. There's an amazing story there. What happens with, again, it declares raptures. It declares different happenings and things in different groups. And it's a very amazing book, and I can't wait to get into it deeply. But I just wanted to give you a little bit of how much there is in two chapters of this second book of Esdras, the first two, and what a blessing it is. And we hope that it blesses you in this our final day of unleavened bread. And this is a solemn time for you and I to again look at what's going to happen now tomorrow in our lives. And what are we doing to have Yahuwah give us, present to us more, to allow us to see more so that we can grow and prepare others in love, not in pride, in the basics of life, not in many belongings and much riches, in the covenant of Yahuwah, in the covenant keeping, in the simplistic way as children of Yahuwah that He declared we needed to be if we were going to make it into His kingdom, and in respect of and declaration of the almighty loving name that is Yahuwah.
This concludes this seventh day audio broadcast of It's Time for Truth. I'm your servant host, Denya Cajaliero, and you need to know that your comments, suggestions, and support are very, very important to us here. Please send your contact email directly to praiseyahuwah@yahoo.com or go to our contact webpage by clicking on the phone icon at the homepage at www.praiseyahuwah.com. This is the day that Yahuwah has made, so rejoice and be glad in it. Until next week, be a blessing to all and be blessed.